Hey, budding lawyers, welcome to the podcast. And today we are going to have a conversation with Ms. Priyanka Pai. Priyanka is a lawyer, a company secretary, and she's currently working with the Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority of India, PFRDA. This time I got it right, right?
Yes. Okay. Congrats to you.
So, Priyanka, what's going? How are you?
I'm in Delhi right now, just enjoying the weather. It's a good Saturday so far.
Okay, you are born and brought up in Delhi or now currently working? That's why.
I'm born and brought up in Mumbai and I shifted to Delhi in February 2021 because that's when I started working with PFRDA, which is a short form of the big name that is Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority. So yeah, it's been a whole 6 months that I have been in Delhi and I'm liking the city this far.
Okay, so this PFRDA doesn't have a branch in Mumbai or what?
No, at the moment it's a small organization. There are roughly around 60 to 70 employees on its rolls and all of us are based out of Delhi.
Okay. Okay, so we are going to talk about your work and exams you cracked. But before that, I just wanted to know something. Like, I know that you are good in academics, were good in academics throughout your college, but was it the same before too, like in your school?
Yes, I have been consistently amongst the top, I'd like to say 5 in my class. And I've been getting decent grades all the while, but that does not mean I did not play the fool. I had my fair share of fun back in school, college, everything. But I believe that all my extracurriculars needed to be supported by solid academic marks. So, which is why I ensured that my marks were up to the mark, to say.
Yeah. So you were talking that you were amongst, you know, top 5 students. So that kind of, you know, this kind of discrimination, if you, I can use the word, is like these are the, you know, toppers and these are someone who are very mischievous and these are somewhere in between. I was there in somewhere in between, not at the extreme ends. But did you experience this in your school and what was it like? Being in that kind of group and others noticing you like that?
In school, I would hang out with the so-called toppers, but the teachers never really bothered me much, even though I did have a bunch of friends who were not amongst the toppers. I was never really given a lot of, flack for not working that much because my course marks, my school marks were fantastic. So I was given a bit of leeway, and even though I did not do my homework at times, or I used to be given punishments, that is to go outside the class and all of those, whatever used to happen in school. But they were again cemented by solid academics. So I did not have to bear the brute end of this stick in school that much.
Okay. But this was the side of your teachers, you said. But what about the view of other students?
My classmates, they were just happy to hang out. I mean, we were what, 8th and 9th standard students, so they just wanted to play the fool. Even I wanted to play the fool sometimes, but I knew where to draw the line. And at home I used to come back and every day would study for an hour or two, so that consistency was maintained. And yeah, but it does not mean I missed out on normal teenage fun. I ensured even that happened, so there was a fine balance maintained.
Okay, so I guess even you were punished sometime for some mischief you did. So can you share something related to that? And I promise this will be the last question regarding your school.
All right, sure. So I remember back in class 9, we had this teacher who used to punish students for not getting geography textbooks to class. And one day, despite having the geography textbook, I saw most of my friends did not have it because they just forgot and they did not pack that book and they were going out. So even I chose to go out with them and I was standing outside the class. But then the teacher knew that, you know, this is extremely out of line for her to not have her book. So she checked my bag and she found the geography textbook. Despite that, she did not give me that much heat because she knew that it's okay. Even if one class she misses just to hang out with her friends, she is going to cover up later on. So incidents like those kept on happening, but I did not actively do something overly naughty in school, but small things here and there, they happened all the time.
Okay, but this was a kind of sweet one. Even I think your colleagues, your friends would remember this, that this happened, you did this thing or something.
Yes, this happened. And more so, what happened after that was quite funny. So when we were standing outside, the teacher came and confronted me and asked me, why did you do this? So I said, because my best friend is here. And my best friend, incidentally, did not get that good mark. So the teacher did not scream at me, but she screamed at my best friend and said that, you know, even though she pulls pranks like this and she does everything, but look at you, you are not in the top five or six in class. So you need to pull up your socks. So the heat was not received on me, but my friend was the target that day. So that is something both of us remember and still have a laugh about it.
Okay. Can you share some advantages and disadvantages for being good in studies, like being a topper in school and college?
Honest, I was never a topper in college because I come from government law college. We did not have much attendance. Yeah. And,
to be frank, do we have toppers in law school?
Yes, we did have a rank list of the top three every class. So all through 5 years, and there were some consistent names in it. I was not in it at all, neither in the first year, neither in the last year. So in college, I would not classify myself as a topper. But that was because I was busy doing extracurricular activities and doing things other than my coursework. So while in college, I completed my company secretary course. I did a diploma in securities law. I traveled around the country, did a lot of debates and moderated United Nations conferences. So even though my academics slacked, it was all right for me because I knew that I was doing something meanwhile. So the lack of the top three grades did not bother me as much.
Yeah, something meaningful you were doing and which you were learning a lot. So that makes sense completely. And this reminds me about when I was in college, like the toppers, even we had like every batch had, but they used to get around 65 or 70% that was the top. So what was it like in GLC?
GLC, honestly, Max, I would like to think that it was in the same. And I would get a 58, 59. So I was always just near the first class boundary, that was 60%, but I didn't meet that 60% criteria. So yes, I graduated with a second class degree.
Okay. So was law your first choice after you did your 5 year course, right?
Yes, I did my 5 year law course from GLC Mumbai. Law was never supposed to be my first choice of a career option, which is why I did not take up the CLAT also. I was supposed to do a CA because my parents thought that that was something which is a very good career. So I was told to go to CPT, that is your CA entrance classes. And that's where, right after class 12, I joined my CPT classes and I came across the subject known as mercantile law, which has basically your three acts, sale of goods, contract act, and partnership. And I realized that this subject is way more interesting than accounting possibly can ever be for me. So I decided to take up law. And that time, since I did not fill the CLAT form, I could not appear for it. And I decided I did not want to take a drop year. So on the basis of your class 12 marks, the best college that I could think of was Government Law College in Mumbai. And I just took their form and filled the form and I got admission, thankfully, and I'm super grateful that happened.
Okay. Could you please elaborate on your time in law school with an emphasis on both curricular and extracurricular activities? Like, you have given us some idea to us, but if you can go into like details of it.
So the first 2 years, I decided to supplement my GLC coursework along with a degree known as company secretary. So by the end of my second year, I completed my CS. I cleared all the stages in my first attempt, all the groups. So I was just 19 when I cleared it. And from third year onwards, I interned. Third, fourth year, I was interning in Tata Motors in their secretarial department. In my fifth year, I decided to do a course, a postgraduate diploma in securities law from my college itself. And in my fifth year, I did a lot of internships in different law firms because I wanted to see what actually practically implementing the law looks like. I did both litigation and corporate law internships. Along with all this, I did a lot of model United Nations and debates because I enjoy traveling and I like meeting new people. So getting a chance to visit different colleges and make new friends was something which sounded really rosy to my ears back in the day. So I did around 50 to 60 MUNs. So in a month, on an average from my third year onwards, at least 2 weekends would be spent traveling and going to different colleges and participating or chairing MUNs. But in college between 2013 to 18, I had a good time and I did not have to attend so many lectures. Yeah, so I attended different colleges, I attended their fairs and saw how they work. And yeah, I did enjoy. I had a fruitful time in college. My 5 years were well spent, I would like to think.
So, you said that you attended around 15 to 16 MUNs. Wait, what? 50 to 16?
Yeah. 50 to 60, yeah.
So, on an average, like per semester, you were attending, oh, say, what, 10 to 15 MUNs?
Yeah, on an average, in a month, if I was traveling twice to go to different cities and visit different campuses for their MUNs, so yes. Roughly between third to fifth year, I would have done that, yeah, easily.
But how did you get time to prepare for it? Because that takes time. And I don't know, I haven't attended an MUN. So, but there will be something like you have to do the research, you have to prepare documents also, right?
Yeah, so I used to do that when I had my free time. I've been an avid newspaper reader, so current affairs, I was abreast anyway. Then geopolitical news and other things you would have to read. Plus, as part of your law college coursework also, you have subjects like public international law. So you have a fair idea of what different doctrines are and what comes under the nuances of international law, at least the bare basics you know. Then you read about different conventions, treaties. So I enjoyed reading. So I read a lot of books in this regard.
Okay, that's really great. Okay. Okay, so let's move on to your work now. How did you get recruited at PFRDA?
Okay, so PFRDA, as well as other financial sector regulators, they come out with notifications. The frequency of these notifications are not determined. They might come out once in a year, they might come out once every 2 or 3 years. And on the basis of that notification, you need to prepare and you need to appear for the exam. So the PFRDA notification came out last July and the exam was held in November. So you are tested on subjects on the lines of logical reasoning, mathematics, general knowledge, English, current affairs, and computer knowledge, along with your specialized stream that was law in my case. So I studied for all of these together and appeared for the exam. And then I was shortlisted for an interview. So roughly out of an applicant size of 1,200 people, 20 people were shortlisted for the interview. And I was in those 20, and there were 1,200 people, to be honest, vying for just 2 slots. So I'm one of the 2 who got selected last year.
Okay, not a surprise. Okay, that's great. So the exam format and all. So how many other exams have you taken, like other government job exams?
I've taken only one exam along with PFRDA, that is the SEBI legal one, because SEBI was an organization I was really keen on working with, and I appeared for the interview also, but I fell short by just 0.6 marks, so I did not get selected. So SEBI is the only other legal exam that I've taken other than PFRDA. I've taken the UGC NET, but that was not for a job. That was because I wanted practice. I wanted to see what sort of questions can be put forth in a law paper. So I took the UGC NET exam way back in December 2019. I appeared for SEBI this year in January and February of 2021 and PFRDA last November. So I've not taken a lot of government exams. Just PFRDA, which was my first exam, and I cleared it, and SEBI after that.
Okay. So did you come across any similarities or any like vast differences between these exams, like the format, the syllabus, etc.?
With my limited experience of appearing for these exams, I'd like to say that the portion was similar. The portion was the same. The portion was the exact same for both of these papers. Different sort of questions asked though, because in PFRD, you had to write answers in brief. So you were given situational questions, like a small paragraph saying that XYZ happened and what are your views on it, which legal provisions have been breached. And you needed to formulate your opinion and write it. Okay. Whereas the SEBI questions were more direct in nature. They were just I'll give you an example. It said, for example, Article 48 of the Constitution, and it would give the first five words, complete the blank. And then you were given four options which were extremely close to each other. So you needed to rack your brain and write the answer. So there was a difference between the two. But again, the manner of preparation for them would be the same. You need to know your bare acts and your famous case laws very well. You need to know the section numbers. So that is about it. But there was not much of a difference in the two papers. But again, you cannot straitjacket this because the experience of every exam writer is going to be different. And what the examiner is going to put forth in the next paper, you do not know.
Hmm. So CB and this one, PFRDA's exam, like quite similar. But UGC NET was very different, like the format and all, right?
Format was different than these papers, PFRD and SEBI, they have negative marking attached to it. So you have to know that your answer is right and only then you can attempt it. Whereas UGC NET, the portion was much more vaster. See, SEBI and PFRD, they are mostly there to check your knowledge of corporate law. So when you see the weightage of the subjects, company law had around 30 marks on 100. Whereas in UGC NET, they are not checking your corporate law. They are checking your all-encompassing knowledge of Indian law. So you had to study subjects like Hindu Marriage Act, family law, Muslim law, all of that, public international law. So it was much more wider in scope, but because there were no negative marking, there was no negative marking in that paper, it was way easier to appear for that paper as compared to this.
Yeah. So from what I know, the UGC NET's exam and Judicial Magistrates exam, they both may be quite similar in terms of syllabus and format, right?
I would have no knowledge about this because I'm not appeared for any judicial exam. I'm not interested in it. Also, the manner of prepping for these exams are different because, see, in UGC NET, once you get a necessary percentile, they clear all the students who have met that criteria. But whereas in SEBI or PFRDA, where you're vying for 2 or 12 slots, so no matter how well you do, if another person gets better marks, he gets the job and you don't. So you fall short of, even there's a difference of marks on the lines of 0.5 marks, 0.7 marks. So it is extremely, extremely close. And that is not the case.
You lost it like for 0.6 marks, right?
I lost my SEBI job by 0.6 marks.
Very competitive.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole lot of applicants studying for these exams and writing, and yeah, you have to be up on your toes and you need to really put your nose to the grinding stone and study for these exams because guess what? There's a whole lot of people studying for these and wanting to get to where you are.
Hmm. So how did you plan for these exams, your studies? And were you working while you were preparing for these exams?
Yes, I was working for the most part when I was preparing for these exams, but for a short duration towards the end, I did take a break. But then again, I joined another job also. So I'd like to say that, yes, I was working for the most part during my prep period. You just have to categorize your time well. That is one thing that I will say, because you need to know what your strengths and weaknesses are and how do you build on those. Because in my case, I knew that my maths and logical reasoning were weak. So I put in extra hours and ensured that that was up to the mark. Similarly, I knew that I was strong in subjects like company law because that is what I have specialized in. So I did not need to put in as much effort in it. So yeah, you just need to know exactly what your strengths and weaknesses are and focus on it. At the same time, I would advise that you appear for mock tests so that you know where you lie and you can work towards that end, towards bettering your percentage.
So did you take any courses or for these mock tests especially?
During prep for PFRDA, no, because there weren't any specialized courses available online. For SEBI, I did take the iExamB legal course, but to be honest, I did not make much use of it because I thought that it's better I study on my own. So I just appeared for 2 or 3 mocks on their website. And for phase 2, I appeared for 2 or 3 English essays. English essay test they have. So just for those. But yeah, for somebody who does not have the necessary time to go through the law books entirely, then I would suggest that they can definitely take up additional coaching online. But these exams, you can also do it on your own. It's not compel. It's not necessary that you need to have additional coaching and only then you will be able to clear it.
Would you suggest any sources for preparations?
Suggestion for preparation for these exams in particular?
For these exams in particular, yes.
IXRP course was pretty good and the faculty was friendly. So that is one course I remember. Other than that, the Anujindal course I believe is good, but I don't think I'm not sure if they have a specialized course for legal students. In case they do, then that would also be a safe bet. This off the top of my head, these are the courses I remember. But more than what courses I joined, I made a lot of use of the content that is freely available on the internet. For example, on YouTube, you have different channels and you can just search MCQs on CPC, MCQs on CRPC, and you get different classes who have their own questionnaires. So I saw those videos a lot. Similarly, for prepping for maths and logic, I made judicious use of resources available on YouTube. For example, there are classes like Talent Sprint, Merit Shine, Feel Free to Learn, who have amazing, simple content on mathematics and logical reasoning. So those classes helped much more than any paid class did, at least in my experience.
Okay. And for UGC NET, would you suggest any sources similar to this?
UGC NET, the exam has two parts. There's paper one and paper two. For paper one, I bought the Anujindal course and that course was pretty good. I took their crash course and I studied their subject matter for 15 to 20 days. That was helpful for sure. Then on YouTube, again, there are a whole lot of options. For example, even Unacademy has a good content. Unacademy has good content in this paper one. So you could just go through their sources. For paper two, not really. I just went back to my law books and read the Bayer Acts at length.
Did you use any apps or softwares which helped you a lot while studying?
Do you mean apps like Forest which help you concentrate better?
Yeah. Anything like for your concentration or note-taking apps, things like that.
Not really, quite old school that way. I did not use any of these external apps.
Okay, so which app did you mention just a minute before?
Forest. I mean, I'm aware of what this app is. So for example, you can set a timer. You can say that for 30 minutes, you will not check your phone. And in that 30 minutes, a tree starts growing on the screensaver that is there on your phone. And if you access your phone in that interim, the tree dies. So that sort of dissuades you from using your phone for a while because you don't want to see a live tree dying.
Okay, so I didn't know about that, but yeah, thanks.
Which help you concentrate better and which help you put off using your phone for a while. But no, I had pretty self-control, pretty good self-control, so I did not feel the need to utilize these.
Cool.
But yes, I'm quite active on Instagram and I use that judiciously. But I did have this thing on Instagram where you can track your activity. And once you can, and so for example, you can set a 20 minute timer. So once your 20 minutes has been met through the day, you get a notification saying that, okay, you have utilized 20 minutes. And after that, you know that, okay, you're not supposed to use it beyond that 20 minutes and you try to put off using it till the next day. So options like these on Instagram, I did use. But other than that, no external study related app was used.
So this option is available in that app itself? It's a built-in feature?
Yeah, it's a built-in feature on Instagram. At least I have an iPhone. So on the iPhone, this app, this feature was there. And it's been there, yes, even now. So it's called, I think, recording your activity. And then you can check your weekly average also and see if you have been staying true to what time you had ordained for yourself. So I put on a notification saying that after 20 minutes, I want a pop-up to come and tell me that, you know, I have met my 20 minutes. So I stopped, I definitely reduced my usage after that 20 minutes. I would not say stop entirely, but reduce for sure. Because everyone knows how addictive Instagram is. And once you start scrolling, you just keep scrolling.
Completely agree. No debate on that.
A fortnight before my exam, I ensured that I did delete the app. So that I did not even want to use this 20 minutes on the app. And once the exam ended, once I came out of the hall, the first thing I would do after all these exams I mean, different levels of these exams was to download Instagram and see, okay, which meme did I miss over the course of the last fortnight?
Crazy. Okay, so given the fact that you have taken the road relatively less tread upon, what would your advice be for lawyers who wish to embark upon the government exam route?
Okay, so one, these exams are a shot in the dark. You need to be prepared for it, okay? Because just imagine there are 1200, there are thousands of people applying for this one or two slots. Now I'll tell you the numbers for SEBI. For SEBI, roughly around 8,000 people were vying for 28 seats in the legal category. So you know that there's a whole lot of competition there, and you need to ensure that you really, really study hard, because one mark, like I said, less than one mark is the difference between you getting the job or not getting the job. So when you're preparing, you need to be on your toes. You need to study and give it your utmost best. Do not waste time doing unnecessary things, because the 6 months, the 3 months that you prepare for these exams, it's going to make or break your career. And once you cross over and once you get a job, then it's smooth sailing all along. It's a secure job and promotions will happen on time, and there is not much work pressure as much as there is in a law firm. So your work-life balance is going to be there and you have enough free time for yourself. So the 3-4 months, that is your peak prep time. Ensure that you prep properly and wholeheartedly. Okay, that is one advice that I would like to give. Then secondly, it's a leap of faith. So I would say that take it. Because when you decide that you want to do this exam and you want to get a regulatory job, so even though the odds might be against you, it's okay. Just give it all your best. Even if you don't make the cut, later on, you know that you tried. So do not get scared of numbers. Like, there are only 2 slots and there are thousands of people applying. Am I going to make it or not? You never know. You just might be the one who gets selected out of the thousands. So do not get dissuaded by the fact that there are such few slots. Just give it your best. And it's okay if you don't make the cut in the first or the second attempt. There are people who have been trying for these exams for years altogether. So try to do that also. Do not give up. Do not give up on yourself and have a little faith.
Okay, so over to our last question. Please share an incident from your career which is very memorable to you.
Okay, there have been numerous instances. I think my time spent in Tata Motors Secretarial Department, that would be a highlight of my career, because it's an amazing, amazing organization to work in. And my teammates, my seniors, because I was an intern there, they were a friendly bunch of people, and I have had memorable times there. One incident that I remember would be meeting Narayan Karthikeyan, who used to be back in the day a brand ambassador for Tata Motors. So one day he just waltzed in and he was really friendly. I just approached him and asked him if I could get a photo with him and an autograph, and he readily agreed. So I still have that photo, and it was a great experience for me, because as a kid I used to watch a lot of Formula One, and I remember reading about his pursuits in the newspaper. So it was a good memory for me to meet him in person. Secondly, in Tata Motors, when I was there, this was October, November 2016. This is when the whole Cyrus Mistry and Mr. Tata, started. So, and then we had to call an extraordinary general meeting. Now, this is something which does not happen all the time. This is a once in a blue moon occasion for a company. And the whole procedural aspect of it, getting the papers in order, ensuring that notices are sent to the shareholders, then getting all the documentation done. All this meant at a short notice that you had to spend a lot of late nights in office. So all of November 2016, we were in office, the entire secretarial team, till 2 or 3 in the night. And it was, of course, there was a lot of work, but it was a great bonding team building exercise also. So I will fondly, fondly remember those days. So it's not one day, but it's an entire month of November 2016 before the December extraordinary general meeting that was held. So yeah, off the top of my head, these instances.
This was before you graduated in law, right?
I was in my 3rd year of college then.
Okay, but this was something like meeting someone. Very frankly, I didn't know about that person, but you said Formula One, so I can resonate like what a personality would have been like there in the office. Okay, Priyanka, thanks a lot for having this conversation with us.
It was a great experience talking to you, and thank you so much. And the viewers, whoever watch it, I hope they get to learn something out of this little chat that we had. Thank you again for having me on board.
Okay, and thanks a lot for watching this episode. Do hit the like button, subscribe to our channel, and follow us on all other podcast platforms if you just want to listen to the audio. Yeah, and also follow us on Instagram, other social media handles, so that you don't miss out any updates from Budding Girls. Bye-bye.